Welcome to the Kitchen Table Theology Podcast. We're Pastor Jeff Cranston, along with our host, Jen Denton, will discuss biblical theology in an understandable way. You'll discover how to apply biblical truth to your life. Thanks for joining us at the table. Let's get started.
Well, hello again, y'all, and welcome back to Kitchen Table Theology. I'm Jen Denton, and along with Pastor Jeff Cranston, we're learning what the Bible says about doctrine and theology. You know, a lot of subjects that many Christians believe are too difficult to handle or understand or just too out of reach. And we're always seeking to do this in a way that is relevant to our daily lives. We love this quote from Michael Horton that says, "We should always ask ourselves whether we're letting the clear teachings of Scripture inform our theological convictions or whether we've allowed ourselves and others to twist the Scriptures to say the opposite of what they really mean." Great quote from a fellow theologian. We want to help you understand God's word so that the life application you draw is in alignment with that word. We started a new series last week, and we're going to kind of bob and weave from that a little bit this week and jump into one of our favorite things to do here at Kitchen Table Theology, and that's a Q&A. But before we jump in to your questions, long awaited. If you waited a week in between last week's podcast and today, I know you're on pins and needles to hear Pastor Jeff's joke about angels. We started that new series on angelology last week, and he promised a joke on angels to kick off today's podcast.
I did, and I don't have it written out, so I'm going from memory here. So I really hope I don't mess this up, but yeah. And so, Kitchen Table Theologians, hello again, and thank you for joining with us. With Jen and I here, we're Zooming again today, but that's not going to stop us. We're just going to keep on trucking here. And well, next podcast, we'll jump back in to our angelology study, and we're going to talk about the purposes of angels within the purposes of God, sort of what's their job description look like. So, okay, so that'll be for next time. But the joke is about two Alabama fans.
Oh, gosh.
They tragically get into an automobile accident and they both die. And they find themselves standing in front of the pearly gates. And they've got on their Bear Bryant checkered hat and their Alabama t-shirt and, you know, the whole thing. And an angel, the angel at the pearly gate says, "May I help you?" And they said, "Well, we're from Alabama and we died and here we are." And the angel says to them, "We've never had anybody from Alabama up here before. Are you sure you're supposed to be here?" And the Alabama fans say, "Well, yeah, I mean, we died and just here we are. We're not sure how all this works." And by the way, Kitchen Table Theologians, this joke is not theologically accurate. So let's just put that out there. And the angel says, "Well, you know, I just can't let you in. We've never had anybody from Alabama up here before. So let me go check with Michael, the archangel." He says, "You wait here at the pearly gates." And the boys from Alabama say, "Okay, we'll wait right here at the pearly gates." So he goes inside and he goes and finds Michael, the archangel. And he says, "Michael, I got a little bit of an issue out here." He says, "We got two guys out there at the pearly gates from Alabama." Michael says, "What? We've never had anybody up here from Alabama before." Guy says, "I know, that's what I told him." And Michael says, "Well, I need to meet with them and talk to them." And he says, "I left them out at the pearly gates." So Michael and the angel go back out to the pearly gates, and the two guys from Alabama are gone, and so are the pearly gates. Jen, I don't hear you laughing.
Well, that's about all the time we have for today's podcast.
Here's the great part about that joke. You can use that joke on anybody. You can put anybody in the place of the out. That joke will work anywhere in the world because everybody's got somebody that they think would steal the pearly gates.
Will it really work, though? Will it?
I've used that joke cross-culturally in about 10 nations, and it people laugh every time, except probably this goodness. Time. You know, I'm hoping it at least elicited a chuckle from one listener. Let's hope so.
I'm sure. Well, hey, speaking of our listeners, today is largely about them, right? With our Q&A session.
Yeah.
So You'll hear us often kind of close out podcasts, reminding you to ask your questions. That's one of the things Pastor Jeff really, really loves. We'll solicit that, have you guys ask those on Instagram or via email. And we have some great questions to dive into today. Our first one comes from Meredith.
Hey, Meredith.
Hey, Meredith. Thanks for listening. And Meredith's asking this, how does or do God's providence and our prayers work together? So we've got God's providence and then our prayers. How do those do they coexist? Do they bounce off of each other? How do they work together? Great question, Meredith.
Yeah, that's a very good question. You know, God's people are taught about God's providence everywhere in the Bible. And the providence of God, let me just try to keep this pretty simple. It basically means God is in charge. God is in control of everything, and God's going to do what God determines to do. That's his providence, just very simply put. And the question, I think, is then why should we even pray, right? You know, but we're commanded to pray, but if we're praying and asking God to change a situation, and God is providential, and he has foreordained everything before the foundations of the world, do our prayers even have any effect? And so I think Meredith knows, I'm guessing by her question, that our prayers work because, as she's written the question, how do God's providence and our prayers work together? So there's assumptions in that question. The assumption is that God is in control completely. And there's another assumption that our prayers do have some effect. And I think, Meredith, you're exactly right there. You know, we see God's providence all throughout Scripture. He sends Moses as a leader to free Israel from slavery. Out in the bush, he supplies food for his people. This is Exodus 15 and 16. God aids Israel in defeating its foes in Exodus 17. He offers God's people his law, so that they can learn more about him, that they can live in accordance with his guidelines and precepts and principles. That's Exodus 20. What's in Exodus 20, Jen? The Ten Commandments, and God providentially gave them. I just finished preaching a four-week series on Jonah.
Great series, by the way.
Yeah, that was a lot of fun. Mm-hmm. And you can see the providence of God. You know, God saves people in a faraway nation by, you know, utilizing the guts of a great fish. You see God's providence in Job, when God allowed Satan to test Job, but he limited how Satan could do it. The New Testament, you see Jesus's life, his death, his resurrection. You see God's providence exemplified in the most profound ways. John 1:29 tells us Jesus entered the earth providentially to redeem us from our sin. Lawless men, Peter says, crucified and slaughtered Jesus. But, you know, and Peter, and when he's preaching in Acts 2, verse 23, declared Jesus was delivered up according to the definite plan and foreknowledge of God. Well, what's Peter referring to? God's providence. You see God's providence in the trial before, when Paul stood various trials, when Jesus stood before Pontius Pilate. And in Acts 4, we read that God had predestined these things to take place. But God's providence, although it's seen everywhere in Scripture, it isn't the only element that stands out throughout the Bible. Though it might appear paradoxical, God's people are also, we are ordered, we're commanded to pray. Mm-hmm. But Jen, on behalf of our listeners, do you know what a paradox is?
I do know what a paradox is. In fact, when you got to that word, I was like, oh, maybe you want to stop and explain that a little bit.
Well, a paradox is two doctors. So, man, I wish
With the jokes today.
I wish I had a snare drum and a cymbal today.
But I'm punching.
Yeah, thank you.
Thanks.
We need to up our games to where we have these at our fingertips, where we can do all these sound effects. Okay.
If you'd like to contribute to the drum and cymbal fund.
So where was I? Why
it was paradoxical. It's an opposition. It might seem like it's an opposition to each other, that God is, yes, he has sovereignty, he's providential, but then we're also ordered to pray.
Right. So thank you for bringing me back from this silliness.
There we go.
So you see in Scripture, not only God's providence, but change being brought about by God's people humbling themselves and praying. Jesus said, look, he taught us the Lord's Prayer, right? What we call the Lord's Prayer. And in that, the Gospels, Jesus doesn't say, if you pray, but he says, when you pray. And when instructing us how to pray, Jesus says, ask in prayer, and it will be yours. James, confess our sins to one another and pray for one another. So, you know, it goes on and on. Paul says, be continually steadfast in prayer. He says, pray at all times in the Spirit with all petition and supplications. You know, this is the same Paul who wrote in Romans 8:28 that all things work together for good for those who are called according to his purpose, and who declared that God's people or our salvation was a predetermined event. Paul said before the foundations of the world, how'd that all happen? By God's providence. Hmm. And so Paul is a strong believer in the providence of God and an equally strong believer in the fact that we are to pray. So all of this leads to this sometimes perplexing dilemma that Meredith gives voice to in the question. And we all encountered it sometimes in our lives. Why pray if God is sovereign? Why should we pray if God is sovereign? What necessity is there for a Christian to pray if God has predetermined everything that will happen and under all of his omniscient power? Does prayer have any effect? Well, let's think about prayer for just a second. When we pray, we have hope and certainty that we have a God who can and will respond to our needs and pleas, right? So God has the ability to accomplish anything he desires. Furthermore, he anticipates what we're going to pray about and anticipates our needs and anticipates our questions before we ever ask the question, before we ever make our petition to him. And I think what God does is he uses our requests to fulfill his goal in concert with us, his people, in some mysterious way. So God utilizes our prayers as a means to the fulfillment of his purpose in some way. So we can emphatically say yes to the question, does my prayer have any effect? Does prayer alter anything? We can say yes to that, even if we don't know how. Mm-hmm. Our comprehension of Scripture leads us to two distinct conclusions, despite the fact that these things are mysteries to us. And that, I think that's kitchen table theologian. I think that's part of what we just have to rest in. Look, if we could understand everything about God, we wouldn't need him. You know, there are elements of God and his will and his working and his ways that are mysterious to us. But here's what we do know, although they are mysterious to us. First and foremost, God's plan is precise and it's unchangeable. Mm-hmm. God doesn't change. The Scripture tells us that. And neither do his ways. Nothing ever happens that surprises God. Everything happens for some kind of reason. Second, we're taught and instructed by God himself to be a prayerful people. So I think we should think about agreeing with the late theologian R.C. Sproul on these points. He said this, whether or not prayer is beneficial, if God orders us to pray, we must pray. Mm-hmm. So the fact that the Lord of the universe, the creator and sustainer of all things, the providential God, mandates us to pray is sufficient reason to pray. However, he not only instructs us to pray, but he also instructs us in our prayer to express our needs. And so, Meredith, to answer your question, and boy, it took a long time to do it. They work together in tandem to fulfill the ultimate purposes of God. He has his providential guidance, leading, will, and ways. And he says, as you're going through your life, pray about these very things. And there's a sense where I think God, in concert with us, works together with us. But let's not kid ourselves. At the end of the day, what God wants to happen is going to happen. But he says, as you're going through this life, you know, pray. And Paul says, and not only pray, pray continually. And I think you see this beautiful marriage than between our prayers and the providence of God.
Mm-hmm. And it is just such a gift. I think, you know, in his all-knowing way, he knows that in our humanness, we need to have that connection to him as our Heavenly Father. And the fact that we have access in that way is always truly astounding.
That's a really great point, which I completely left out. I missed the whole relational aspect of prayer, which you just brought out. That's a great, great point.
Mm-hmm. I also like kind of R.C. Sproul's comment, it is what it is. Yeah. whether it's beneficial, it's beneficial or not, he tells us to do it. So great, I like that.
Great theology in a nutshell. It is what it is.
I don't know that that applies to everything. In this case, it does. Well, thanks, Meredith, for the question. Thanks, Pastor Jeff, for that very good explanation of that. Our next question comes from my friend John. I do love me some John. You love yourself some John, too. He's been a great addition to our church family. He and his wife are just precious. And John asked this question. As a Christian, does having peace about a decision give assurance of God's direction? Oh, that's a good one. As a Christian, does having peace about a decision give assurance of God's direction?
So I think inherent in that question is, if I don't feel an inner peace, it can't be God's will.
Mm.
Okay?
Mm-hmm.
You know, and we, I think, find ourselves measuring the will of God or determining the will of God for our lives based on peace. Quite often we do that. When we're faced with a big decision, we ask each other, you know, if I come to you and I go, hey, Jen, got this huge decision to make. I'm not sure what to do. I could go this way, or I could go that way. And quite often conversations between two Christians like that, you might answer me, well, do you have a peace about it?
Mm-hmm.
You know, do you feel at peace about the decision? And if we do, then the answer generally comes back, well, then I think God might be in that. You know, maybe that's, yeah, I think that's what you ought to do because you have peace.
Mm-hmm.
And we think that wherever peace goes, we should go too. But lately, I'm wondering if peace is actually the foolproof compass of God's will. We imagine that it is. If you read through the Bible, most of the people in the stories had really scary assignments. Go someplace you've never been, fight a giant, give birth to God's child, die on a cross.
I don't think Abraham had peace when he was walking up on that mountain with his son.
With the knife in his back pocket.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, but was he in God's will?
Yeah.
Absolutely. You know, nothing about those assignments screams peace to me, at least not peace in the way we usually think of it. So when I think of the word peace, I think of a warm bed at the end of a long, cold day, you know, a hug from my wife or a hug from my children, my daughters and my grandchildren. That's something very peaceful about that. And for some people, the will of God may feel like that. But for me, seeking that sort of peace to determine the will of God has led me astray just about every single time. I have felt peace about decisions that were really, truly wrong for me.
Mm-hmm.
I was praying about it. I was seeking the Lord's guidance. But I still had a total peace that I should do it in spite of the red flags that were fluttering in the breeze all around my head. You know, often God's will is something that scares us absolutely to death. Something that you feel little peace about. Not always, but certainly sometimes. You know, I don't hear a voice from above, and no matter how hard I beg and plead, God rarely gives me the kind of confirmation that I'm looking for. But along with a major lack of signage when God is leading me somewhere, there's times I often have a distinct lack of peace.
Mm-hmm.
But on the other side of those fear-filled decisions have come the sweetest parts of my life.
Mm-hmm.
I remember scared to death to go on my first mission trip, but I didn't have a lot of peace about it, but I went and it changed my life. I visited, I think, 42 countries in the world.
Wow.
A lot of times, you know, you walk off the plane and walk out of the airport, you're not feeling any peace.
Mm-hmm.
Great. I had the opportunity in one trip over 22 days to circumnavigate the world. in ministry. I wasn't on an airplane for any less than 9 hours. I think 9 hours was the shortest flight.
Goodness.
A lot of non-peace things happening there, but it was a phenomenal ministry time. One time in my life, I left a solid established church ministry as their lead pastor, and I became the pastor of a church that was small, that was struggling, that was weak in many crucial areas. But in that respect, you know, most of my most terrifyingly issues where I was seeking the will of God, when I went ahead and stepped out, retrospectively, they have been the best decisions of my life. So if we're going to do life the way Jesus did, then peace might be the wrong thing to hope for or pray for. You know, he said, take up your cross and follow me. He said, lose your life to gain it. And I don't know about you, but losing my life sounds quite incredibly non-peaceful.
Sure. Sure. I mean, it's literally, it's probably where it is a step of faith, or I think, you know, we often call it a leap of faith.
Yeah. The step of faith is one thing. The leap of faith is entirely, you know, you're getting then into fear. You're getting into the unknown. You have no idea what's waiting for you at the bottom. Your heart feels like it's going to come out of your throat. You know, there's this acute knowledge that if God doesn't show up, I'm dead here. You know, I'm done for. That's a leap. And yet I'm reminded of William Carey. William Carey is known as the father of modern missions. He was a missionary in Africa and China. I mean, the guy was unbelievable. If you have never read Kitchen Table Theologian, a biography of William Carey, C-A-R-E-Y, William Carey, go find you one. And I'm telling you, it will change your life. But he said this. He said, attempt something so great for God that if God not be in it, it is doomed to fail. Attempt something so great for God that if God not be in it, it is doomed to fail. I don't know about you, Jen. I don't hear a whole lot of peace in that one.
Not a lot.
Yeah. You know, and you think about God's people throughout the years as you read the scriptures or you just look at church history. The people of God have conquered kingdoms. They have shut the mouths of lions. They've died for things they knew were good and right and pure and gospel-oriented. There's been a number of God's people who, you know, have been crazy, radical, kind of by the skin of their teeth and by the grace of God sorts of people. But God tells us not to be afraid. He tells us to be strong, but to be courageous, to trust him, to have faith, to not doubt. Because with the kind of life we're going to live with him, we're going to need that, those things. And it doesn't always feel peaceful, but it is always good. And so, John, to answer your question, does having peace about a decision give assurance of God's direction? I think the answer is quite strongly, not necessarily so. Because often the way God is calling you may completely be a direction that is not going to bring you peace at the beginning. But at the end of the day, I think you'll know greater peace than you've ever known before when you take that leap of faith.
Because again, as our first question pointed to, it is all under his sovereignty and under that providence.
Right.
Yeah. Great question, John. Thank you so much for offering that up. All right. We got one more today. You got one more in you?
I do. And this is not an easy one.
Well, let me tell our listeners.
I read this when it came. I'm like, oh my word.
So our friend Tomoko, hello Tomoko, is throwing us for a loop today, sounds like. So, all right. So let me set this up.
Very, very good question and one we ought to wrestle with.
All right. So here's the setup. In the story of David, Bathsheba, and their illegitimate son, the baby died not long after he was born. Here's Tomoko's question. Did David's baby die because David sinned? Later in David's life, we also see that David's sin affected all of his children and the kingdom, and it brought David so much sorrow and suffering. It looks like maybe God used David's children to punish him. Ooh, great question, Tomoko. Let's see how Pastor Jeff's going to tackle this one.
Well, thanks again for joining us, everybody, and tune in next time.
There just isn't enough time.
This is a great, great, great question because, man, it's a true story. It's filled with pain, sin, strife. It would make any, this is not a story that would make the Hallmark Channel.
Probably Probably not.
But David hooks up with Bathsheba. They have a child. And just shortly after its birth, the child dies. And is this a result of David's sin? Was God using David's child, his son, to punish David for because of his sin? You remember in 2 Samuel 12, the prophet Nathan confronted David about his sin with Bathsheba, and he pronounced a judgment on David. And unfortunately, David and Bathsheba's young son died as a result of that judgment. So, in view of what we know about God's justice and his compassion for children, which is off the charts, the reality that an innocent child dies instead of the guilty couple is very unsettling to us.
Mm-hmm.
So let me see if I can shed some light on a couple of the challenges here at hand. We've got to recognize that no matter how much we grow in our understanding of God and grow to accept what we view as some of God's quote-unquote harsher deeds, we can never be free of the visceral reaction we have when a child dies, especially a baby, just a couple of hours or days old.
Mm-hmm.
The death of a little one should make everyone sad. You know, in a world filled with sin, God must do a lot of uncomfortable things. However, God never intended for us to be at ease with sin. He never intended for us to be at ease with its consequences, which includes its punishments. The consequences of sin ought to disturb us. They ought to make us feel sick to our stomach.
Mm-hmm.
This is something I think the mature Christian will recognize, but it doesn't make life in this fallen world any easier. In the case of David's infant son's death, some people blame God for the child's death. There's two basic grounds of disagreement in our thinking that can generate some problems here. The first is that God was not stern enough with David. But that claim ignores the context of the scriptures in question. God did, in fact, chastise David three separate times before this was going on. He said, "Your house, David, will never be peaceful again."
Mm.
He said, "You will be publicly chastened for your private sin." And he said, "Your son's going to die at the end of this." And those three judgments were outlined by Nathan. And Nathan said this. Well, Jen, you've got that there, I think, that 2 Samuel 12 passage. Would you read that for us?
Sure. So now, therefore, the sword will never depart from your house, because you despised me and took the wife of Uriah the Hittite to be your own. This is what the Lord says. Out of your own household, I'm going to bring calamity on you. Before your very eyes, I will take your wives and give them to one who is close to you, and he will sleep with your wives in broad daylight. You did it in secret, but I will do these things in broad daylight before all Israel. The Lord has taken away your sin. You are not going to die. But because of doing this, you have shown utter contempt for the Lord. The son born to you will die.
That is really hard for us to swallow.
It is. That's a talking to, my grandma would say. He is getting a talking to for sure.
And you got to remember, David is the leader of Israel, the chosen people of God.
Mm-hmm.
And I think of that verse in James chapter, oh gosh, it's either chapter 2 or chapter 4, where he says to teachers, you know, hey, teachers, we're going to incur a stricter judgment. As the king of Israel, David was going to incur a stricter judgment. You know, some things were worse than death in an honor-based culture, which is what the Middle East at this time, this was an honor-based culture. And there were some things worse than death in that honor-based culture. Dishonor would be horrible for a normal citizen. But again, David was no common citizen. He was the king. And God reminds him that he's the king. So while God did not punish David just solely for his sin. The punishments he experienced caused him to live in shame. And David was certainly not given a free pass. God obviously did judge him for his sin, but David just didn't get a slap on the wrist. I mean, it was a public disgrace, a public humiliation. There's no longer going to be any peace. In other words, there's always going to be war. You guys are always going to be fighting with other people. And the son that's going to be born to you out of this sinful act between, you know, this adulterous affair that you had, that son is going to die. Another point of disagreement, or something that we really find it hard to deal with, and I'll start to wrap it up. It feels to us God is unjustly punishing this baby boy when God allowed this disease or whatever it was that killed him. But as you read it, God wasn't punishing the child. God was punishing David. Mm-hmm. And David's grief was so intense that his servants actually thought David was going to die. In 2 Samuel 12, we read this, David begged God for the child. David begged God for the child. So apparently, as soon as the baby was born, they knew he was in deep trouble. And David went on a fast, and David slept on the ground in sackcloth. The elders of the family tried to help getting up off the ground, but he wouldn't get up off the ground, and he refused to eat with them. And on the sixth day of its life, the little boy died. And David's entourage was afraid to tell him that the child had died, because Scripture tells us they reason, if we tell him the child is dead, he might do himself some harm. Mm-hmm. We're afraid to tell David that his son died because we think he's going to kill himself. So this infant death was intended by God as a punishment for David and his sin. But let's not forget this part of it. This little boy was brought into the arms of God after a brief sickness, as are all innocents. And we just talked about this.
That's what I was just thinking.
Ago, right? And as hard as it looks to us and what it makes us feel from an earthly perspective, being in the arms of God is the best place in the universe you can be. Mm. Now, that death did not absolve David, but you know what? When David sinned, he stole the possibility of a life lived out by his child, and that was a terrible theft. Life is wonderful. Life is thrilling. God has a plan for every existence. However, and it's speculation, but we can speculate that God, and I think we can call it sort of an educated speculation. Could it be that God was preventing, by the child's death at 6 days, could it be God was preventing something worse? Because God presents his other children as illustrations of how this child's life might have played out. David's own son tried to steal the kingdom from him. Mm-hmm. They were having blood battles, David and his son. His children were a cause of much grief to him, some of them, throughout his life. Their lives were troubled lives. If this little six-day-old boy had grown up to reject God like his brothers, his death at 6 days old was his salvation that he may have not had he grown up to be like his brothers. Mm-hmm. You know, the death of a child never feels right, and it will never seem right to any reasonable person, but it can be right when it's ordered by God. In this case, I think it was indisputably true, because God allowed this child to die. Who knows what God was saving that child from in its future had it been allowed to live? Was David being punished for his sin? Absolutely so. Mm-hmm. Did God use the death of his son to punish him? He absolutely did. Mm-hmm. However, let us not forget that that child, upon its death at 6 days, immediately was ushered into the very presence in the arms of his heavenly Father.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Wow, that was some question, Tomoko. We sure are glad that you asked it.
Yeah, Tomoko, you don't get to ask any more questions for the rest of the year.
Just kidding. We always welcome all of our listeners' questions. And if you enjoyed today's podcast, then keep asking those questions because we'll do more of these, right?
We will. Yes.
Yeah. So speaking of enjoying today's episode, if you did, then recommend this podcast to your friends and family, maybe share it on social media, and do hit subscribe wherever you get your podcast and leave a rating or a comment. You can also check out any episode notes that we have from today's podcast or any other resources. We touched on a lot of things in answering these questions that we just covered in our last series. So you may want to go ahead and check those out. You can freely access those in the archives. And also check out Pastor Jeff's sermons, books, and blogs touching on a lot of these issues to help you grow in your faith. You want to talk about our topic for the next podcast again really quickly?
Yeah, back to angelology. It'll be the second in the series. And we're going to talk about the job description, the purpose, the roles of the angels in the kingdom of God.
Gotcha. Well, hey, as we leave you today, we want to encourage you as always to remember that the real power of theology is not only knowing it, but applying it.
You've been listening to the Kitchen Table Theology Podcast with Jen Denton and Pastor Jeff Cranston. Join us next time for more insights into biblical truth. If you'd like to know more on today's topic, you can check out the show notes at jeffcranston.com. You can also email us at pastorjeff@lowcountrycc.org. If you're enjoying this podcast, would you consider leaving a rating and review on iTunes? We deeply appreciate your help in getting the word out. And be sure to subscribe on iTunes, Google Play, Spotify, or in your favorite podcasting app to continue this journey with us as we learn about and apply God's word to our lives. Thanks for joining us, and we'll see you next time here at Kitchen Table Theology.